The church is sacred. It's reverent. Holy. But the church is more than just a building. It can be much bigger when we let it be. The church is people. It's you. It's me. It's all of us. And this is a program about the church that's happening in our world today. Hi, I'm Bobby Schuller. Welcome to the program. Today we're beginning a new series called Life in the Spirit. You know, all of us have this incredible thing available to us, the Spirit of God, which can give us strength, can encourage us, can strengthen us, can push us forward, can give us wisdom. It's this thing that's always available to us, but most of us, for whatever reason, don't turn it on. In the busyness and hurry of life and our desire to always do another job, another project, another errand, we have this source of life available to us and it's so easy to just ignore or forget. We believe that if we can tap into this incredible source of life, that our lives would be completely different. So over the next 6 weeks, we're going to study what it means to receive the life of the Spirit every single day so that we really will have joy and love for our neighbor and life in the midst of circumstance. I also had the opportunity to hang out with Caitlin Crosby. Caitlin has a really great story. She grew up in Beverly Hills and all of the affluence that comes with the valley. And so she decided to rebel. And her way of rebelling was going to church and youth group and doing good for people. Out of that emerges all of these justice initiatives, which she's going to tell us about a little bit in our interview coming up. But for now, let's head on over to Shepherd's Grove.
Glory to God. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, just let me stand. Oh, I am tired, I am weak.
There's darkness in the world all around us, and when we see the darkness, we have the ability to do one of two things, to ignore the darkness or to really want to do something about it. Sometimes when we want to do something about it, though, we feel powerless, and that's why the Holy Spirit is made available to us. The Holy Spirit is the power to go into darkness and bring light. Coming up next, I'm going to talk about the person of the Holy Spirit and how He empowers us to be chain-breaking, light-bringing people.
Today we're going to talk about the Holy Spirit. I went to Fuller Theological Seminary, as many of you know, which is a mostly Presbyterian Reformed seminary, even though it's broadly Protestant evangelical. But before that, I went to a little more siloed of a school called Oral Roberts University. Now, when I began at Oral Roberts, when I first heard of it, I thought it was a dental school. I actually had no idea who Oral Roberts was until I attended the university. I had heard some joke about three famous pastors going to hell or something, and one of them was my grandpa and the other was Oral Roberts, so there, I had some vague recollection of this person. I can't tell the joke. It's... All right, the joke goes like this. This was not... No? No, Don says no. All right, we're going to move on. But the punchline ends with the devil saying, "You've got to take Robert Schuller back. He's raising money for air conditioning." Anyway... All right, anyway. I had all sorts of schools that I wanted to go to, everything varying from Point Loma to Harvard. I mean, I had lots of colleges I was looking at. And I chose Oral Roberts for one reason, for worship and for the character of the students and the way in which those two things were married to each other. I knew that if I went to college, I was going to become like the people that were in that college. What I found myself, as I was living in Oklahoma only for a couple years at the time, I started going with my sister to these worship services at Oral Roberts University. They were at 7 o'clock at night, and we would begin worship, and we would go for 4 or 5 hours without stopping, and we'd go till 2 in the morning, and you would leave, and you can come and go as you wish, but you would leave feeling like it had been 10 minutes, completely refreshed, renewed, and restored. Out of that, we had this worship team. I was a part of it, and a lot of famous musicians were part of it. Carrie Jobe, Glenn Packiam, Jared, and others were a part of this team that just created new songs like David did in the Book of Psalms, and new prayers and old songs. There in the classic, you know, Assemblies of God way, there was no structure. Really? I mean, there were planned songs, but who knew if anybody was going to stay on the reservation? And although that's not at all what I'm saying we need to become as a church, that's not what I'm advocating for. I'm just simply saying that that was a place where I truly experienced just a real openness to the Holy Spirit by a student body. And I witnessed how that thirst and hunger for paraclete made some of the most fruit-bearing Christians I'd ever seen, and realized that this isn't about being Pentecostal, or charismatic, or dispensational, or Reformed, or Baptist, or whatever, that regardless of what kind of Christian you are, whether you're Catholic or Protestant, that you need the Holy Spirit. You need the Holy Spirit. I long for the days in which a congregation could really pray for 5 hours and leave feeling like it was 10 minutes and not leave feeling like they just engaged in some type of asceticism, but really left feeling refreshed, renewed, and restored. I long for a spirit of revival. I long to come to a point as a church when we stop talking about all the great things God used to do, all these miracles we used to see, all these breakthroughs that we used to be a part of. I don't want any more used to's. And so we're going to talk about the Holy Spirit, okay? I promise I'm not going to have everybody speaking in tongues, but so just let the anxiety come down, all right? Okay, let's start with the ascension. If you have a Bible, you can follow along with me. Acts chapter 1, verse 1. You cannot understand the Holy Spirit until you understand the ascension. Many of us understand the crucifixion and the resurrection, but we don't understand how the ascension is also a key part of that. This passage wasn't read today. That's right, we did the Apostles' Creed. So I will read it again, and I'll read it slowly. Acts, the book of Acts, is a sequel. Did you know that? In seminary, we called it Luke Acts, and it's because Luke, his first book is the book of Luke, we call it, but the second book is the book of Acts, and he calls it the Acts of the Apostles, but the way we call it the Acts of the Apostles, but the way you ought to sort of read it is the Acts of Jesus through the Apostles. You'll see at the beginning of this passage, he talks about how Jesus is going to continue his ministry in this story, even though Jesus sort of ascends at the beginning. So let's read, follow along here. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day he was taken up to heaven after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit. Listen to how often the Holy Spirit, by the way, is mentioned in this passage. Through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water,
but in a few days, you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Then they gathered around him and asked him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel? And he said to them, it is not for you to know the time or dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, while suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. Men of Galilee, they said, why do you stand here looking into the sky? The same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven.
This is one of those passages that's like, you know, preacher gold mine. I mean, like, this is, there's just so much imagery in this. I say that all the time, I know, but this one is really good. There's this period between the resurrection and the ascension when Jesus gets weird. He starts to do stuff that he didn't do before the resurrection. He starts to appear and disappear. He's veiled and then all of a sudden reveals that it's him. He will go through doors. He has this strange angelic kind of thing going on where he seems to pass in between, as theologians we would say, the realm of heaven and the realm of this universe. Just back and forth, like it's no problem. And we have these stories in which Jesus keeps appearing and disappearing to the disciples, and this is really important. He continues to be with them, and they don't know it's him, and then he reveals that it's him, and then disappears. And what he's doing is revealing to them that they're going to be in a new posture and relationship with Jesus. Up to this point, Jesus has been like a rabbi, so they hang out together, they eat together, they go to the bathroom in the woods together, they sleep around the fire, they, you know, they joke. They've been hanging out for 3 years. Jesus is in his early 30s, and believe it or not, the 12 apostles were in their late teens. And so there's this group of young people that has been hanging out with this coach or mentor or rabbi, this person that they're looking up to for 3 years, and they hinge on his every word. Beyond those 12, there's a larger sort of group, sometimes called the 72, might even be bigger than that. So there's sort of this group of people that's sort of always with Jesus wherever he goes. And that's gonna change. Jesus is gonna move from kind of constantly being with them to sort of, they never know if he's there or not. And there's lots and lots of these stories after the resurrection. One of the most famous is the road to Emmaus. Here's two guys, two of Jesus' disciples, and they're walking to Emmaus, and there's this fellow journeyer, and they don't know who he is. And the whole time, he's talking to them about the scripture and about Torah. And then they break bread, which is a symbol of Eucharist, and their eyes are open, and they realize it's Jesus. And then he vanishes. And they say, were not our hearts burning within us the whole time he spoke? How did we not recognize that was Jesus? It happens in the story of the nets going on the other side. You know, the Jesus' disciples after the resurrection are trying to catch fish, and they can't, and then there's this guy on the shore that's telling them to throw their nets to the other side. And they're like, well, yeah, come on. And this guy, no, throw your nets to the other side. I'm like, who's this dummy over here telling us to throw our nets to the other side? And so they finally do. They throw their nets over, and of course it comes up filled with fish, and then they realize, it's the Lord! Right? One of the most famous is the story of Mary, when she goes to the tomb and she's looking for the body of Jesus and she can't find it and she's weeping because she thinks that her rabbi's body has been stolen, and she's just angry about the wickedness of someone stealing the body of a loved one, and sort of looking through tear-clouded eyes, she sees a man that she thinks is the gardener, and the gardener says, Mary. And when he says that, she's like, it's Jesus. There's lots of these stories where Jesus is with people, but they don't recognize him. And what Jesus is doing is teaching them that he is going to be present with them in a different way. He's not going to be present with them as a guy, you know, with a staff and his robe walking alongside them in the way that they're used to. There's going to be a new, actually more powerful way in which Jesus is going to live with them and be alongside them and comfort them and teach them. And Jesus is going to become omnipresent by becoming the church. And that's such an important theological statement. Jesus, through the Holy Spirit, is going to become omnipresent by becoming the church. And the disciples don't want this to happen. Remember what Mary says? She goes to reach for Jesus, and what does Jesus say? Mary, don't touch me. Now, normally, there's no problem with that. You know, women would touch Jesus and hug him and things, but this is different. There's a deep statement in this. Mary, don't hold on to me. Don't hold on to my body in this way. And I would maybe say, because you're going to become my body. That's a little odd, I know, but I'm going to use you to continue my ministry in your life, and not just through you, everyone who believes in me and has been given the Holy Spirit. And so Jesus is sort of preparing them. And in this 40 days when he's sort of appearing and vanishing, the passage we just read in verse 3 says, and while he was doing it, he was always teaching them about the kingdom of God. So it's like every time he appears, he's talking about the kingdom of God, the kingdom of God, the kingdom of God, over and over, over and over. And so right before he ascends into heaven, what is the question they ask him? Jesus, are you now going to restore your throne to Israel? Are you going to restore the kingdom of God to Israel? When Jesus, the Jews love numbers. They love them. They wrote a whole book called Numbers. And so when a number is mentioned in the Bible, especially in the Old Testament, it's a really big deal. It is a big deal that Jesus chose 12 apostles. Do you know why? Because the number 12 for a Jewish man or woman is always, always associated with the 12 tribes of Israel, with all of Israel. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. Jacob has 12 sons, and those 12 sons become the 12 tribes of Israel that make up this nation and body of people. Jesus specifically picks 12 apostles in order to project the very clear message that he is going to restore Israel and that he is the prophesied Messiah. And so this is on everybody's mind as they're following him, because the kingdom of God phrase is not something Jesus mentioned. This is all invented, rather. It's all through the scripture. And the way in which Jesus' contemporaries view the kingdom of God is that God's going to come back. He's going to make Israel kind of like Rome, where Israel, through military power, will become the sort of global dominant government. And from that throne, goodness and righteousness and justice will flow, unlike the bad governments like Rome that have idolatry and that are unjust and that are pagan. God will use the small nation of Israel and Jerusalem will be its capital, and the whole world will be ruled by the kingdom of God, which will be a literal government. This is the view that the Jews have, not far from what you see from contemporary Islam today. The eschatology for contemporary Islam, that the end of times is that many believe that Islam will sort of, not all, but some sects of Islam believe that Islam will be an actual government, that Sharia law will rule the whole world, and when that happens, there will be justice and righteousness. This is a very kind of Middle Eastern way of thinking. They think Jesus will be the king of an actual literal kingdom that's an actual government that has a military and has its own roads and its own postal service. And that will become the kingdom of God. And then so you've got these young men in their early 20s and late teens following Jesus, and they're stoked because they're gonna get the top jobs in this government. They're gonna be generals, and they're gonna be bureaucrats, and they're gonna be governors, and they're gonna have land and property, and they're gonna sort of rule justly. They're going to be like the Knights of the Table Round with King Arthur, you know. They look forward to being on the inner circle of the king's court. And so when Jesus dies on the cross, when he's crucified, this what they think is a fantasy sort of vanishes, and they go, okay, this isn't going to happen. There isn't going to be this new government. And so when Jesus is raised from the dead and he's talking about the kingdom of God, they're kind of like, oh, well, maybe this is actually going to happen now. Maybe there is going to be this government. And so Jesus says to them, No. That's not what I'm talking about. But yes, I am going to be king of this kingdom. And yes, it is going to rule the whole world. And no, it's not going to be like Rome. And no, it's not going to have its own military. It's going to be something much bigger and better than that. You know, when Jesus ascends into heaven, what does he ascend to? Do we know? He ascends to his throne. And so although Jesus is not becoming the king of like a government, Jesus is becoming the new king of the universe. And that through him, all nations and all kingdoms will be healed. That true justice will come. Not through government, but through the hearts of men and women. And that by being the king of their hearts, he will transform the whole universe and reconcile it to his Father. Isn't that good news? Isn't that good news? And so Jesus says, essentially tells them that he's going to sit on this throne. And the word that we often use is this word gospel. That's a pretty slide. It's the first time I've looked around. That's really nice. He uses this word gospel. Gospel is an old English word that used to mean God spell, meaning God's spell or God's message. And it comes from euangelion. Euangelion, you see that first one, eu, is, it means good. Engelion means message. You'll notice that it's the same word as angel, because an angel is a messenger. And this is the word where we get evangelism from. Euangelion is the gospel. And this gospel is a contemporary word not invented by Christians. When a great battle was won, or when a king ascended to a throne in the midst of anarchy, heralds would go out into all the land and proclaim the euangelion. They would herald the good news that a new king has ascended to the throne and that his reign is coming and that you better get your stuff together and you better get things right. Because the reign of the king is coming, and you better get on board with it. It's good news. It's good news that anarchy is over, and that there will be law, and there will be justice, and there will be goodness and rightness, and things will be set right by this king. And so the good news, the evangelism, if you hear anything I say, evangelism is going into all the world, all the darkest, worst, heinous places of the world, and saying, Jesus is king of this. Preaching the gospel is going into Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth where there's the worst injustice, where there's the greatest pain, and saying, Jesus is the king of this. This will be set right. Proclamation, a heralding of the gospel is to say, Jesus is king. Jesus is king of my marriage. Jesus is king of my church. Jesus is king of my country. Jesus is king of sex trafficking. That will come to an end. Jesus is king of dirty water in Africa. That is not the king's way. That will come to an end. I proclaim that's the gospel. People are separated from God, living in quiet desperation, lonely, broken. No, Jesus is the king of this life, and he will redeem it and rescue it. And so evangelism in the gospel is proclaiming that the ascension happened, that Jesus sits on the throne of the universe. And that's very, very good news, isn't it? That's very good news. And so Jesus says, you know, before you go and before you proclaim this, you need to wait. Don't go yet. You need to wait for the big guns. That's what I call them. Big guns. You need to wait for the big guns. You need to wait for the Holy Spirit, which will give you dynamis or dunamis. Dunamis is power. It is the word that we get dynamite from. It is literally explosive power to do my work, to actually enact my rightness, to actually believe thy kingdom come, thy will be done in Orange County as it is in heaven. Amen. That there is in this power the ability to speak, not as a pretender, but as a true proclaimer and herald of the king, that this will be undone and I'm going to do it. Because I've been given the big guns. I've been given the dynamis. I've been given the power. I've been given paraclete. This word dynamis literally means, from Strong's, inherent power, the power to do miracles, and the power to be a moral person, and to do what is right in the face of great evil. Power. Jesus gives a name to the Holy Spirit. He calls him paraclete. This is a word we often use, paraclete, as like a noun to describe the Holy Spirit. We often think Holy Spirit is his name. But a lot of scholars really think that when Jesus refers to this comforter, this advocate, this helper, this comforter, this word paraclete, that maybe Jesus is actually calling him by name. The third person of the Trinity, paraclete, he's a person. Some of you say, well, isn't it she? It's just, don't give it a gender, all right? We're just gender neutral here, all right? Paraclete. Comes alongside. That's literally what it means. Paraclete means called to one side, to be a friend, to be a helper, to be the power. And that is what the Holy Spirit does. It empowers the heralds of the kingdom of God, those who are going to dark places, proclaiming that Jesus is king. It's the power to undo that darkness. It's the dynamite, the good dynamite. And then here's the thing. Here's where I want to step on everybody's toes, okay? You ready? I want to ask you this question. Is the church inoculated to the Holy Spirit? What do I mean by that? The only way to immunize someone for smallpox is to give them cowpox, a weaker, watered-down version of the illness. The way to immunize someone from polio is to inject them with dead polio so that their body rejects polio. And the only way to inoculate the church from the Holy Spirit is to inject a weaker, dead version of Christianity. Are we immunized? Have we been inoculated? Have we spent so much time in our books, in our seminaries, and in our small groups and studying the Bible to have some form of godliness but deny its power? To get this thing we can clearly and obviously call Christianity and yet be powerless and weak? Do we have in all of our rites and all of our practices and all of our rhythms everything that looks and talks and acts like Christianity without ever truly knowing Christ, without ever knowing its power? Are we inoculated from this? Are we comfortable enough in our church to say we are Christians without Christian power? The first time I saw the Holy Spirit moving was on a missionary trip to Thailand, with some of the darkest, most horrible spiritual bondage. We couldn't pretend to be Christian there. We had to have the paraclete. We had to have paraclete doing our work for us, doing miracles, breaking chains. That's a place where kids were sold into sex slavery and where real demonic worship was happening. We couldn't pretend to be Christian there. We had to actually have dunamis there. I'm really concerned for the church in America, guys. I'm really, really concerned. It's too easy to be Christian here, to pretend. It's too easy to inoculate ourselves from the Holy Spirit. And I don't know what it means to blaspheme the Holy Spirit, but I've often wondered if that's just it. You know, I'm sorry to keep to stay on this. Did you know you can't like Jesus? You know, Jesus, everywhere he went, was the most polarizing figure. People either said, "We worship you," or they said, "Crucify him." Everywhere Jesus went, he polarized people. They picked a side, and he didn't necessarily force them to. There was just something about the power of the Spirit within him that people said, I must bow down before him and worship him, or I must kill this man. You cannot like Jesus. You cannot be kind of Christian. We must have the Holy Spirit, and we must have its power. So the Holy Spirit, Paraclete, the third person of the Trinity, is in you if you're baptized. If you are baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you have the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit continues to do great things in the world today. He does miracles. The Holy Spirit still heals people from sickness. The Holy Spirit still prophesies. The Holy Spirit still gives words of knowledge. The Holy Spirit still teaches and gives direction. The Holy Spirit still speaks to the church. You know, I was in line for tacos yesterday. Talking to a guy about church. And he sort of got quiet for a second and crossed his arms, a young guy, probably 21, 22, and turned to me and said, "You know what? God just wants me to tell you that whatever it is that's going on in your family, he's going to sort it out and everything's going to be okay." And he looked like, as he was saying it, he was like really nervous. Like God put this thing on his heart and he was like really wrestling with the Lord on whether or not he should say this. And I said, "Do you know? Did somebody tell you? Do you know?" He's like, "No, I don't know. I don't know what this is about. It just the Lord told me to tell you this." Come to find out that this guy, for those of you who don't know, my son has epilepsy, and this is something we've been dealing with, and just had a seizure last week after going like 3 months without one, so we're kind of concerned about that. And this guy was epileptic. He was an epileptic child, and so every day of his life, he would have one seizure every day, grand mal seizure, until he was 12. And then at the age of 12, it stopped. And he said, "I'm a testimony. Everything's going to be okay." So God used a rescued epileptic child that's now a successful young man, and he was obedient to the voice of the Holy Spirit to speak into my life. The Holy Spirit is alive. Paraclete is at work. Are we immunized? Are our hearts too cold? Are we going to say, "I don't need that, I have my Bible"? Are we going to say, "I don't need that, I have our hymns and our spiritual songs, and we have our Sunday morning worship, and I don't need the Holy Spirit because everything's fine"? Or are we going to say, "There are dark places, evil places, and we will go in and herald that Jesus is king of this"? And not just pretend, but have real power to do what God wants us to do. Real power to raise the dead. Real power to speak into people's lives. Real power to teach with authority. Real power to have spiritual knowledge. Real power to pray and undo spiritual chains. The answer is yes. And over the next 6 weeks, we're going to continue to navigate through this. Amen? Amen. We're going to know Paraclete.
If this message was meaningful for you, we want to send you a study guide called A Curriculum for Christlikeness. Listen, ideas are one thing, sermons can be encouraging and motivating, but actions are another thing altogether, and that's ultimately what we want. We want people watching this program to not just be encouraged and inspired, we want people to become a different kind of individual, making a difference in the world around them. We think the Curriculum for Christlikeness, our study guide, can do that for you. You can use it in your own personal study, you can use it in some kind of a small group. If you would, just write to us or go to the website and we'll send it to you for free. Our address is P.O. Box 100, Garden Grove, California, 92842. Coming up next, I interview Caitlin Crosby, and I really had a great time interviewing Caitlin. Caitlin is a very funny person, but she's also very sincere about her faith. And it was very fun sitting across from her, talking back and forth, and kind of hearing what it was like for her as sort of a Christian, faithful, religious person growing up in a very kind of secular, vain environment like Beverly Hills. She's very funny and very interesting, and I hope you enjoy this interview. Caitlin, hi. It's so nice to see you. So glad you came down today to tell your story. And you really do have a pretty amazing story. Didn't have to come far. You're in LA.
Yeah.
And let's start there. So your parents, you grew up in Beverly Hills. Mm-hmm. You went to Beverly Hills High.
Yes.
Your dad managed like a bunch of like famous rock stars, and your mom was like on Chips and was a model and an actress.
Yes.
What was it like? I mean, tell me about that. You know, everybody's so curious.
It was very different. My dad manages a lot of infamous people, and yeah, my mom was a model and an actress.
And like, did you go into like sex, drugs, and rock and roll and just go nuts?
Definitely not. I did the opposite because my dad like wanted me to be cool and like party, so my rebellion was going to youth group. So also my rebellion was not only that, but it was also in the whole body image world, and how when I would spend the night at my dad's house on the weekends, it was like the posters, the movie posters and the headshots, they were all around. So I'd be 12 years old and covering up all my pimples because I didn't want him to see any flaws. So, and I grew up acting as well, because it's just kind of like what you do when you grow up there.
Yeah.
And so growing up, going on auditions and being scrutinized and then leaving, and they're like, thank you.
So there is an incredible amount of pressure on women today,
aren't
there?
Oh my gosh, it's awful. Every girl that I know deals with it. So that's like my goal in life for myself and for women too. And just like knowing that all that is a fantasy, it's not real. And even if you have that girl on the poster, like I was that girl on the poster, that's still not satisfying because there's another girl on a poster. And then once you have her, you won't be satisfied because there's another girl on a poster.
That's right.
And you don't know them.
Yeah.
And they don't even look like that.
Yeah.
So it's all fantasy.
Yeah, it's a big fantasy, yeah. So you're a musician, right?
Mm-hmm.
And what was that like? How did that inform kind of what you're doing today?
So I just started writing songs about everything that I saw kind of behind the scenes in the industry, et cetera, again, as like a therapeutic thing. But one day I was at, in New York, and the hotel, was a real old hotel key, but you know, these days they're usually credit cards. So hotel key was huge. So I put it around my necklace because I got compliments on it all the time. And one day, the next day I was at a locksmith, and the person ahead of me got numbers engraved, and I was like, oh, do you by any chance have letters?
Yeah.
Can you engrave love your flaws on this key?
Yeah.
And so I said, oh, and while you're at it, do you have any old used keys? I saw all these old like discarded keys on the side that were like rusted and cool and like like this ish. And I said, can you engrave like hope and strength, faith, grace, fearless,
let go,
etc.
Yeah.
And then I started selling them on tour at the merchandise table.
You get a key,
mm-hmm.
and you make sure every key is unique, right?
Mm-hmm.
So there's no two of kind.
Yeah.
It's like snowflake.
Exactly.
And then you get something printed on that key,
mm-hmm.
and how do you decide like what word goes on there?
At first, I just did all
random
the different
words.
Positive words I could think of. My favorite part is once you get one, you're just to wear it for a little bit, for a season, own your word, and then your homework assignment is you have to pass it on at some point to somebody that you feel needs the message on the key more than you.
Awesome.
And then it could be a year later, a month later, when someone, let's say you're wearing your key and you love it, whatever, and then someone's saying, oh, I'm, you know, just going through a breakup, or I just lost my job, and then you have to give it to them at that time. And then you tell them, they have to embrace the word, and then they have to keep their eyes open, and they have to pass it on. So it's a whole pay it forward movement.
Yeah.
So then people started writing me all these stories.
Mm-hmm.
So that's when I thought to start the website, thegivingkeys.com. And then the homework assignment is, once you give your key away or you get your key, you have to write the story of why you gave it away.
So the key is the idea that you're trying to inspire people with like a particular word.
Yeah, so at first it started with the pay it forward movement, and that was, again, could have been enough.
Yeah.
But then I knew there was a missing link. I knew I wanted the money to go to some sort of charity. I didn't know what. There was maybe 6 months to a year where I thought of a ton of ideas that would have been fine, like, you know, give proceeds to this nonprofit. And I was waiting for that aha moment.
Mm-hmm.
So one day I was walking on Hollywood Boulevard. I left church by myself, and I wasn't thinking about the Giving Keys at all. And I saw a homeless couple, and they were sitting under an umbrella holding up a sign that said, ugly, broke, and hungry.
Oh.
And so I went
up. It said, ugly, broke, and hungry?
Yeah. So it caught my
terrible.
Eye. I know, I went up to them, I was
it's
like,
really
why
sad.
Does your sign say that?
Yeah.
I was like, what's your story, et cetera, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
I think I asked them if I could pray for them or something like that. And so I did, and then I said, are you guys hungry? Like, I was gonna bring them food, but then I was like, you know what? I'm gonna take you guys to dinner. Let's go to a restaurant.
Yeah.
And they were like wet, and they lived in a dumpster. They literally lived in a cardboard box when I met them. And so we went to this cool restaurant on Cahuenga, Kitchen 24. you know, and just getting their life story. And they were so amazing. And the guy, he was raised homeless on the street. His parents still lived under a bridge.
He was raised homeless?
Yeah. His parents literally.
So, like, his whole life was, like, mm-hmm. as a kid, he was homeless. And this has always been that way.
Mm-hmm. But the girl, I said, I like your necklace. And she said, oh, thanks. I like making jewelry. And I was like, oh, this is, you're the missing link to the Giving Keys. Do you guys want to be my business partners? And that was my aha moment.
So your first business partner was two homeless people you met outside of a out of church.
Yes. Now we're in almost 900 stores, and we're
awesome.
In 120 Nordstroms and Anthropology and this. It's crazy. So obviously they couldn't keep up with that. So then we partnered up with Transitional Homes, United Way, and Path, and Chrysalis, and now they would screen all the people for us to make sure we're hiring people that are clean and sober and really ready to change.
But still, you just met this couple, and you kind of like kill a bunch of birds with one stone mm-hmm. in a kingdom way. So like, even though the keys themselves are sort of meant to encourage people and sort of help people through the dark times of their lives, you actually hire people that are really struggling, that need work to kind of help them overcome and learn a new skill. And there are business people who are watching that go, like, what if my business could be more than just the bottom line? Like, what if somehow in the process of doing business, I could either employ people that need to learn new skills or create a branch or something out of my business that helps those in need? I mean, is that something that excites you? I mean, is that something that...
Yes, I'm super passionate about this. I don't understand why people wouldn't do that.
Yeah.
So my question to people would be, why not? I mean,
I think
there's a balance of, I think the most important thing is actually caring about the cause first. But it really came from like a place of genuinely caring about these people. So I think that's step number one. I think, you know, you guys, for everybody to really pray, like, God, give me your heart for people. Give me your heart. Like, give me your heart for the things that break your heart and all that kind of stuff. That's, I think, number one. And then once that starts to happen, I think, yes, use your business, your nonprofit, your church, your this, your whatever you're doing. If you work at Starbucks or you own a huge company, have a branch or this or percentage or something that goes to whatever cause that God has put on your heart.
Yeah.
I mean, why not? It's such a waste. My whole life I always prayed, God, give me your heart for people. Give me your heart for people. That was like my go-to prayer my whole life. And I really feel like he answered that prayer in the Giving Keys, because I feel like it really is his heart. Like, everyone keeping their eyes open for their fellow man and just the cute humans and people going mm-hmm. through hard things and keeping your eyes open. Like, how can you help, whether it just be a simple thing and giving this word away, giving your cool necklace away to somebody. And it's just, the stories are mind blowing. But yeah, and employing these people that some people are like, they've been in jail for almost 30 years and they've never had a job and they'll never be able to get a job. And this is really their only opportunity. Yeah,
that's awesome, Caitlin. I'm so proud of people like you and you and that you guys are really making a difference through your company mm-hmm. and seeing the value of organizing, even for profit, to make a big impact for the homeless, our homeless neighbors, and also just to encourage people, you know, in the dark times in their life. I think it's really, really great. And glad we get to kind of be a part of your story and hear a little bit. Thank you so much for coming.
Thanks for having me.
And I hope you can come back again. I look forward to hearing to see how your story continues to evolve.
Sure.
Friends, we're so glad that you've taken this journey with us to think through what the Holy Spirit can do in a world that has so much darkness. God wants to use you and fill you with his light and life, and then inject you into the darkness to bring light to it. We always want to end these kinds of journeys with a spiritual discipline, especially when we're talking about engaging with the Spirit. We have to be people who are praying and practicing things that bring us closer to the image and likeness of Jesus. And so in this time, in order to wrap up this this journey, we want to finish with a prayer. And this meditation was written by Bill. It's from Psalm 74. And it's essentially meditating on the baptism of Jesus. And so what I want you to do before we go into this prayer is to imagine yourself being baptized in the Holy Spirit in the same way that Jesus was baptized in the River Jordan. When Jesus was baptized, it says that the heavens were torn open. By the way, it never says that they closed again. And the Holy Spirit came from heaven and landed on Jesus. And the Father said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." God says that about you, that you are his beloved daughter, or you are his beloved son, and that he cares for you. And remember, when God says it over Jesus, Jesus hadn't done anything yet in his ministry. I mean, he wasn't saying, "This is my beloved Son," because he's gone to the cross. He hadn't done that yet. He hadn't done anything. he'd just been a carpenter, and God was just blessing him and loving him. And so as we read this prayer, imagine yourself falling into the presence and the goodness of the Holy Spirit. Precious dove, remain on me. Precious dove, remain on me. Father's gift, remain for me. Christ's presence, remain with me. Dear Spirit, remain in me. And again, as I read these words, imagine yourself falling into the Holy Spirit. Precious dove, remain on me. Precious dove, remain on me. Father's gift, remain for me. Christ's presence, remain with me. Dear Spirit, remain in me. Lord, we're so thankful for your Holy Spirit. Thank you for the Comforter. We love you.
They say that depression from infertility is one of the hardest ones to deal with.
We had this life plan that we had laid out, and I think it was actually for three kids, right? We used to say it was for three kids.
You expect something to happen, and you hope that it's going to happen, and it doesn't happen. And you just feel that there has to be some other reason why. There's some bigger presence out there that is in charge of things.
We grew up in agnostic households, both of us, so it's not that we were atheists or we didn't believe in God. It just wasn't really spoken about. It wasn't really an issue in our household. Infertility sort of threw us for a loop, and for the first time in our lives, we really started looking around and thinking seriously about religion and praying, and found our way to the Our Power on TV.
We were going to do a fifth IVF cycle, and we were going to pull out all the stops, going to take the medicines, and I got the stomach flu, and I couldn't do the cycle, and we had to cancel and lose our deposit, and thought, okay, well, this is it. You know, we're not going to be able to do this anymore. And that same month, we found out that I was pregnant. We were at our lowest point, and now we have three kids. Didn't know if we would ever even have one. I don't like to tell people, oh, it's okay, you know you're gonna have a baby, like you'll have a baby, because they might not. You have to get to the point where you know that whatever happens, that you've done what you can do, and God will give you what you need. It might not be what we want, but it'll be what we need. Because God blesses all of us.
If you're in sort of a spiritual crisis and you're looking for hope, it's really the right place to be. You want to hear that all things are possible with God. You want to hear that God wants the best for you. That's exactly the kind of message that we needed at that point in time. I came to Christ through the Our Power. That's how it happened for me.
We found that there is hope, that you know, there is a plan. God has a plan for all of us.
We're one story of one family that this program has changed the very course of our lives. I can only imagine about all the other stories out there.
So friends, so thankful that you've joined us today, and we hope that you leave feeling refreshed, renewed, and restored. Your sins are forgiven, and your soul is made new. And so the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.